This is Jeff Klein, editor of RadioGraphics, and today I'm pleased to have with us Dr. Gensuke Akaike from the Division of Nuclear Medicine in the Department of Radiology, and Dr. Tomoko Akaike from the Division of Dermatology at the University of Washington in Seattle, Washington, who are authors of one of our featured papers in the current November 2019 issue of RadioGraphics. And their paper is entitled Imaging of Merkel Cell Carcinoma: What Imaging Experts Should Know. Doctors Akaike, welcome to one of our November 2019 author podcasts.
Hi. Thank you, Dr. Klein, for a kind introduction and this opportunity. Before starting, I'd like to thank all my co-authors for their tremendous support and input.
Well, thank you for joining us today. So let's begin. Gensuke, you describe Merkel cell carcinoma as an aggressive cutaneous neuroendocrine malignancy with high mortality, typically diagnosed at an advanced stage of disease at time of presentation. Can you review for our audience why we are seeing more of these patients and why you decided to present this material from your medical center at the RSNA 2018 meeting? And by the way, I want to mention that your exhibit received a certificate of merit in addition to being solicited for submission to RadioGraphics.
Thank you. Yes, Merkel cell carcinoma, or MCC, is a rare type of skin cancer, but the incidence is rapidly increasing. Also, there are many interesting immunological or imaging features, and now it is one of the hottest topics in the fields of dermatology and oncology. Multidisciplinary discussion is often needed, including radiologists and nuclear medicine physicians. Therefore, it is important for imaging experts to be familiar with MCC. However, MCC is not well recognized among radiologists, and we think it is important to raise awareness of this entity among radiologists. And Tomoko can go over more about this disease.
Thank you, Gensuke. Yes, so MCC is rare, but its incidence is increasing rapidly. So the PowerPoint, the PDR2 shows a change in the number of cases of all solid tumors, melanoma, and MCC per year, normalized to the year 2000. Between 2000 to 2013, the number of MCC cases increased by 95%. Strikingly faster than all solid tumors, which was by 15%, or melanoma by 57%. So we think the aging of the baby boomer generation is one reason why. The baby boomer generation will pass the 65-year threshold in 2025, and this increased the risk of MCC markedly.
Thank you. So, Tomoko, after the introduction, your paper details the clinical features associated with Merkel cell carcinoma with risk factors including immune suppression, in particular those receiving organ transplants or with chronic lymphocytic leukemia. The paper offers the acronym AEIOU to summarize the pertinent clinical features of Merkel cell carcinoma. Can you review this acronym with us and perhaps share with our audience the recognized causative factors found to be associated with this rare malignancy?
So this is one of the clinical manifestations of MCC, which is shown in your manuscript, figure 2. The AEIOU acronym summarizes characteristic features of MCC. A stands for asymptomatic, E expanding, E immune suppression, and O order them for 50 years, and lastly, U stands for UV exposed or fair skin. Indeed, a study has shown that 89% of patients present with three or more of the AIEO characteristic. However, these features are non-specific and thus, it is very difficult to diagnose MCC. Therefore, MCC-specific management is usually initiated after a surprising pathology result has been, received by physicians. So there are two major causes of MCC. Approximately 80% of MCC cases in the United States is caused by Merkel cell polyoma virus. This virus was discovered in 2008. Merkel cell polyoma virus infection itself is very common, and most people have been exposed to this virus by adulthood. Merkel cell polyoma virus doesn't cause any symptoms except in very rare situations such as mutation, which leads to MCC. So the remaining 20% MCC cases are caused by extensive UV exposure.
Thank you so much. So Gensuke, the article proceeds to detail the staging and prognosis of Merkel cell carcinoma, with staging using the TNM system, which is relatively straightforward. You then focus on the role of imaging, beginning with the evaluation of the primary lesion and regional spread of disease. Can you discuss the imaging features that are commonly encountered in the primary lesion, and then have you review figure 5, which shows a case as seen on CT?
Okay, yes, just like there's no specific clinical features, there are no imaging characteristics specific for MCC. However, there are some evocative imaging findings we commonly see. The features include cutaneous or subcutaneous nodule or mass, which can be sessile or fungating. So figure 5A is an example of primary MCC manifested as an exophytic soft tissue nodule. Other findings include focal or diffuse skin thickening, which can be seen in figure B or figure C. And necrosis is frequently seen as is demonstrated in figure C, but from our experience, calcification is not common.
Thank you. Gensuke, the next section of the paper deals with the subject of sentinel node biopsy to detect subclinical lymph node metastases. At your institution, you use technetium-99m sulfur colloid for lymphoscintigraphic sentinel lymph node mapping. Can we review figure 7 that demonstrates this?
Yes. So we use 1 millicurie of technetium-99m sulfur colloid, or sometimes technetium-99m tilmanocept, which is also known as lymphoseq, for sentinel lymph node mapping. So we inject the dose intradermally at 4 locations around the primary site or primary biopsy site. So we obtain multiple planar images to look for the sentinel lymph nodes. And in this figure 7, there's an intense focal uptake, which represents the injection site around the primary tumor. And there's a faint uptake in the right lower neck. And this is likely a sentinel lymph node. So then we use a handheld gamma probe to confirm this node. But we routinely perform SPECT CT for anatomically complex lesions like head and neck, because SPECT CT has higher sensitivity and higher spatial resolution. So these are figure 7B to D, and you can clearly see the uptake corresponding to sentinel lymph node. So after the finishing our sentinel lymph node mapping, the patient is sent to the operation room, and the sentinel lymph node is further confirmed in with blue dye and handheld gamma probe in the OR as well.
Great, thank you very much. So Gensuke, in the evaluation for nodal and distant metastases, we know that a significant percentage of patients with Merkel cell carcinoma present with metastatic disease. And your paper provides multiple examples of metastases in various distant sites. While there are no features specific for MCC metastases, you do indicate that FDG PET CT performs well for this function outside of the brain.
Yes, the utility of FDG PET CT is increasingly recognized. First of all, MCC is a very hypermetabolic tumor, so it is often easy to appreciate on PET scan. And FDG PET CT can scan the entire body, including the the head and neck to the extremities. And also, it provides metabolic information and limited anatomical information from non-contrast attenuation correction CT. And during follow-up after systemic treatment, it is not uncommon that the changes in metabolic activity precedes the changes in size and shape. So this is very important for follow-up with patients with who's undergoing systemic therapy, such as immune therapy. So a large meta-analysis demonstrated that FDG PET CT has sensitivity of 90% and specificity of 98%. And some other studies showed that higher sensitivity of FDG PET scan for detection of bone metastasis when compared to CT. So in general, FDG PET CT is very useful.
Thank you. After a discussion of treatment options, which usually involves surgery with radiation therapy and systemic therapy used depending on disease stage, the paper mentions that there is no consensus regarding the utility of imaging modalities for follow-up assessment of treatment response. Can you share with us how patients with treated MCC are followed at the University of Washington?
So at our institution, we think a blood test to detect antibodies to Merkel cell carcinoma virus is beneficial for all newly diagnosed MCC patients. Approximately half of MCC patients produce antibodies. If patients produce antibodies, this test can be used to monitor for disease recurrence, as it is an extremely sensitive way to detect in these patients. So the presence of antibody against MCC oncoprotein is indicative of a more robust anti-tumor immune response and is associated with better prognosis. On the other hand, in patients who don't produce antibodies, radiologic scans are very important to monitor for disease recurrence, and patients should be followed with scans. Frequency could be modified depending on each patient's initial stage and other clinical and pathological features. At our institution, baseline FDG PET CT is very important to stage appropriately. There is no consensus regarding the choice for follow-up imaging modalities, but we usually follow patients with contrast CT.
Thank you. Gensuke, the final portion of the paper addresses the role of various nuclear medicine imaging studies in these patients. It seems like FDG PET CT is clearly useful for initial staging with high accuracy, and that it significantly impacts treatment options, decisions, and management in up to 40% of patients. Now, MCC somatostatin receptor-seeking nuclear medicine agents such as gallium-68 dotatate, which have a high affinity for MCC, are emerging as alternatives to FDG PET CT. Can you discuss the potential role of dotatate in the evaluation of these patients? And we'll look at figure 18, which shows a case of MCC evaluated with dotatate.
So MCC has unique characteristics of the neuroendocrine tumor and express somatostatin receptors, or SSTR, on tumor cells, which can be imaged by SSTR-seeking nuclear medicine studies such as indium pentylotride octreoscan or gallium-68 dotatate PET. The potential advantage of gallium-68 dotatate is that it may be able to detect well-differentiated MCC tumors which are not very FDG-avid. That in gastrointestinal neuroendocrine tumor, it is well known that there is inverse relationship between SSTR expression and FDG ability. That is, low-grade, well-differentiated tumor has high SSTR expression and therefore are more dotatate PET avid than FDG. Whereas high-grade, poorly differentiated tumor are more FDG avid than dotatate. Also, dotatate PET is often easier to read than FDG PET. It usually has a better lesion to background contrast ratio from our experience. Another potential advantage of dotted PET is that positive uptake indicates the presence of increased somatocell receptor expression, which can be used for SSTR-targeted therapy, including somatostatin analogs such as sandostatin, or more recently, lutetium-177 dotted radionuclide therapy. However, the relationship between SSTR expression and tumor grade is not fully understood in MCC, and further study is needed. So more investigation is necessary for this exciting possibility. Figure 18 shows widespread metastasis with increased somatostatin receptor expression in a 60-year-old patient who had underwent resection of a primary MCC in the left knee. So this MIP image demonstrates foci of increased radiotrace uptake in the left supraclavicular area, mediastinum, and retroperitoneum, and left inguinal region. It is very easy to detect these very high intense foci.
Thank you so much. Dr. Tomoko Akaike and Gensuke Akaike, I want to thank both of you for taking time today to discuss your paper on the imaging of Merkel cell carcinoma, which can be found in the current November 2019 issue of Radiographics. Doctors, thanks so much.
Thank you so much.